We're going to continue our study in 1 Timothy, as we've been doing right along. And our topic today is what good ministers do. What good ministers do. Because that word minister is going to actually occur in our text. All right? We're all ministers. Actually, truly we are. We think of the pastor as being the minister. And in this passage, he's going to talk to Timothy about being a good minister. But there's a sense in which we are all ministers, because God has given us all ministries. The truth is, the word minister means servant. It means servant. And so for a pastor to say, I'm a minister, means I am a servant. In fact, you remember Jesus said, when he was asked who's going to be the greatest of all must be the servant of all. And so the way to greatness is to be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, not the boss. And that's a little hard for us sometimes. Sometimes when we go to our prayer time, we pray and kind of dictate to God what we want, right? God, you need to do this, this, and this. And then in the name of Jesus, I pray, amen. Whether I'm the servant and should be saying, God, what would you have your humble servant do? God, what would you have your minister do? 1 Timothy chapter 4, and we're picking up with verse 6. If you notice in 1 Timothy chapter 4, if you've all found your place in 1 Timothy, just raise your hand real quick. Yep, you found your place in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6, he says, if you point these things out to the brothers, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus. You see that? Good minister, good servant. Do you know that there are bad servants? Yeah. Obviously, the bad servants don't point these things out. What things is he talking about? He's talking about the things that have preceded it and the things that are about to be told here. He says, if you point these things out, brothers, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus, brought up in the truths of the faith. Now, if I had my slides up, I'd have that word truths highlighted, and the good teachings that you have followed. So we would have highlighted the truths and the teachings. And I'd say mark your Bibles, but I think you're all using a pew Bible right now. I don't think you want to mark the pew Bible because you're not taking that home with you, okay? But what do good ministers do? Good ministers point out things from the Bible, truths. They point out things from the Bible, teachings, that are not necessarily politically correct. Isn't that something? It's not the minister or the servant's job to be the most popular person. Do you realize that? The minister or servant's job is to be the most obedient person. And so when he's telling Timothy, he's saying, Timothy, listen, if you're going to be a good minister, you have to be an obedient minister. And an obedient minister has to point things out that sometimes are not popular. You think when Nathan the prophet went before King David and he pointed to him and pointed his finger at him when he told the story how a neighbor had taken another neighbor's lamb when he had his own, and David got all upset and said, we got to judge that man. And then he points his finger at him. He says this, you are the man. He pointed something out. He pointed out what was not politically correct to accuse the king of a sin. That is the job of a servant, to obey God. You only want to be popular with your master. No one else matters. And so he's saying, Timothy, if you're going to be a good minister, a good servant, you're going to have to point out things that are not necessarily politically correct. In fact, you could become very unpopular for those things. As I look at this text, he says there in verse 6, if you point these things out to the brothers, family of God, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus, brought up in the truths of the faith and the good teachings that you have followed. He says, have nothing to do with godless myths. So the first point in your outline was he points things out. The second one is he trains in godliness. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tale. Rather, train yourself to be godly. He trains himself to be godly. That's what a good minister does. Now, in this passage, I notice there it says in verse 8, for physical training of some value. And I know some of you, you work out every day. You've got your treadmills. You got the bikes that you ride. Some of you do crunches. Some of you lift weights. Some of you jog. Some of you go to the mall and you walk. I call that shopping, but some people go there and they do walking. And I know you do that. You know what the passage says? It's of some value. Good for you. You know, if you're really going to exercise, though, and it's going to be effective, you don't do it once a week. You do it every day. And to work out and physically get the limited value from exercise, you work out a little bit every day, and you make your routine a little harder. You work so you're kind of sore and it hurts, because you know then it's being effective and it's accomplishing something. You work out and you walk until your heart is beating harder. You know, you change the incline, all that. So it's a struggle. You break out of sweat. And he says, all of that is of some value. Some value. But notice what he says. He says here in verse 8. He says, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promises both for the present life and the life to come. When I work out in the Word, I get in the Word and I work out, okay? I get an exercise. When I read through, oh man, Leviticus? Are you kidding me? I'm reading through Leviticus, all these priestly codes that make no sense to me. He says, listen, he says, God is going to bless your life just for reading the Word. If you jump to the Revelation, you'll see in the beginning of Revelation, he says that God will bless you for just listening to it or for reading it. You don't even have to understand it. You just read it, and God will bless your life. He says he'll bless you somehow right now in your life. And then he says, but the blessing you get from being in the Word, he says, it holds promise for both the present life and the life to come. And the life to come. God blesses you now. I call it now and later. I think they make a candy called that, now and later. He blesses you both now, and he blesses you later in eternal life. Now, just before that, he says, have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tale. He says, listen, don't waste your time on that which is unimportant. What's important? The eternal truth of the Word of God. Good ministers, good servants, good ministers and good servants, they pay close attention to the Word of God. They point things out from it. They train themselves. It says, train yourself. So this is an exercise program you've got to put in place for yourself. The next thing he says in verse 10 is that he hopes in God. He says, beginning of verse 9, this is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptation. And for this we labor and strive, that we have put our hope in the living God. I like that expression, put your hope in living God. Well, where else would you put it? Well, some people don't put their hope in a living God. Some ministers don't even put their hope in a living God. They put their hope in marketing, if I market right. I mean, for a while there's this movement going through the evangelical church on church marketing. If I market right, my church will grow. Some people put their hope not in God, but their talent and their skills. Some people put their hope in God in their oratory. Some people put their hope in God in their personality. Instead of God, they put it in, they misplace it. But he says here, the good servant who points things out and trains himself in godliness, he says this person puts his hope in God and God alone. In God and God alone. He goes just a little bit further. He says here in verse 9, it's a trustworthy saying. You can count on it. You can count on it. And then he adds this. He puts his hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all men. Now, some have concluded from that, then that must be universalism. Everybody must get saved. He's the Savior of all men. Well, the idea here, because he's going to go on and say, especially of those who believe, what he's saying is, all men who are saved are the ones who especially believe in Jesus. So if a person is saved, they've done it by believing in God and God alone. There is no other way to be saved. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, if you read this passage closely, notice what it says. God, who is the Savior. But Jesus claimed to be the Savior. So if God is the Savior and Jesus is the Savior, then Jesus must be God. You see how subtly this is weaved in? It's not even a huge theological point. It's just there. That when we come today to worship, we come to worship God, but we've come to worship Jesus. Because Jesus is the Savior, especially of those who believe. Imagine that you're a lifeguard, and it's your job to save people when they're drowning, right? And so there's someone out there drowning, and you dive in, and you go to save them, and as soon as you get to them, they start beating on you, say, get away from me. I want to drown, right? You would have still been the Savior because you went to the rescue, but they're refusing to say, you're the only Savior that could save them. But they're refusing your rescue. So when he says he's the Savior of all men, there's no one else that can save. But this is especially true for the person who embraces Jesus as their Savior because they get saved by him. You see, a good minister, he knows the salvation of our Lord, and he places his hope in that salvation and no other place. In the 11th verse, he goes on and he says this, command and teach these things. Command and teach these things. He's been talking about the faith. What do I command regarding the faith? Well, I command people to believe. Did you ever notice that it says in like Acts 16, 31, and other places, it's an imperative. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a command. God is commanding us to believe. And then he says, and teach. You're going to notice that this idea of teaching keeps popping up in this passage because a good minister is a teacher of the truth of the Word of God. He says, command and teach these things. Well, the question is, what are these things? It follows. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. But set an example. Don't let anyone look down upon you because you are young. But set an example. Obviously, at the church at Ephesus, there were some older people, and they were looking down on Timothy's youthfulness. His youthfulness is he's like about 40 years old, okay? And he says, don't let anyone, one text puts, despise your youth. The number one thing we can do as a church is encourage young people in ministry, in service, to be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And ask and actually set the example. So the young person here, he's telling him, don't get bogged down because older people are not liking the way you're doing things. Every now and then, I don't like the way the grandkids are doing things. Like, all thumbs and no conversation, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I have to get out my phone I text back to them, hey, I'd like to talk. You see, I don't necessarily like the way they're doing things. You know, it's true in the church. You know, generation after generation, it was going on then, it goes on now. It was going on then. They're looking down upon Timothy because he's young and he's trying to follow the pastorate at Ephesus in the Apostle Paul's big shoes. And he's being looked down upon. We want to build up our youth. We want to pass the baton onto our youth. We want to raise up leaders from our youth to become leaders in our church. In 2 Timothy 2:2, he's going to say, the older teachers teach the younger ones so that they are able to turn around and teach another generation. That is our task. Our task is to reach those who are younger. He says here, command to teach, do not let anyone look down on your youth because you are young, but set an example for the believer. Now, there's a catalog list here of things. He wants them to set an example as believers in speech, what you say. What you say. I think he's saying to Timothy, because the other passage, parts of the letter here and the next letter in it, that he's saying, you do not rebuke someone who is older than you. Listen, if that older person doesn't like the way you're doing it, or whatever what he's doing, I don't know, maybe he's implementing new worship style or something, and they don't like the way you're doing that, he says, don't rebuke the elder person. You just set the example. You just serve God with all your heart. He says, set the example for believers in your speech. Don't rebuke. Don't get angry. Don't get frustrated. Don't scream back. Don't do anything. Let your speech be seasoned with grace. I think he's really talking to all of us as servants. We're all servants. You know, I often say when people are in an argument, you know who wins? The person who talks the softest. You know why that is so? Because the more you lose control, the louder you get. And the more you're out of control, the more you're losing the argument. But the more cool, calm, and collected, and while they're raising their voice, if you start lowering your voice, you know, it really does. It makes them all the more angry. They raise it even more, but at some point they realize. I'm screaming like a person out of control, and this other person is in control. Who's winning this argument? The person who's the quietest, who's the softest. He's saying, watch your speech. Let your speech, set the example in speech. And in your life, he says, Timothy, don't just talk it. You live it. I just finished reading a book. It's called Growing Young. Nice title, huh? But it's about the church. The church needs to grow young, okay? And the book is actually about how to reach the millennial generation. The largest group consider themselves nuns. None as in none of the above. They're the nuns. Are you Protestant, Catholic, Jewish, whatever? It says they put none of the above. They're none, okay? And to reach this group, the conclusion is there's no formula. There's no magic rabbit to pull out of the hat. You do this. It says what you have to do is you have to live your faith in a legitimate, real, authentic way so that they see you living it and they realize it's real in your life. And they want authentic Christianity, not a to-do list Christianity. They want to see loving your neighbor as yourself in real life. Not just a good sermon about it on Sunday. And that I can put an offering into a collection for the needy and remove all my responsibility from that. They want to see us get actually involved in touching people's life. And when I get involved and I'm really touching a young person's life, I'm actually living out what I say I believe, they say, that's authentic. That's worthy. That's something I can get involved in. I want something authentic and genuine and real in my life. I don't want the person to get up and tell me all the wonderful things God did in the past. I want the person to tell me what struggles they got right now. And that Jesus is getting me through those struggles right now. And so that they could just come alongside and say, I want to see Jesus, really see Jesus in your life, not in your talk. And that's what he's telling Timothy. Listen, be the example in your life. Paul will say in 2 Corinthians that our lives are letters. We are living epistles. Some gospel people read, the only gospel they ever read is your life. And if I'm not really living it authentically, they get a distorted gospel and they're turned off. And he's saying here, be an example. Be an example in speech, in life, in love, like the Good Samaritan. You're carving out the time. You're using your resources to help. Be the example in faith. We just finished the book of James, a faith that works. If you say you believe, then you're going to act on that belief. I believe God is going to do something in any area. If I think God's going to do something in my community to change it, then maybe I'll run for office. Because I believe God's going to do something. I have faith. I believe. I act on what I say that I'm trusting God for. I actually act in that. I believe that God wants so-and-so to accept Jesus as Savior. If I really believe that, won't I go to him and say, hey, I got some good news to share with you about Jesus. I act on that. It's acting, a faith that is actually put into action. And he says, in purity. I don't think there's anything that turns off unbelievers more than a person who claims to be a Christian and then has an impure lifestyle. It could be just as subtle and as little as where it says, let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth. That I claim to be a Christian and I love my neighbor as myself, and then I have road rage. And I'm screaming and yelling at some idiot. And there's somebody in my car and they're saying, oh, that's the way Christians act? No different than anybody else, right? No different than anyone else. He says, in purity. He says, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of the scriptures. Now, they weren't so blessed at the time of Timothy as you are to have a Bible in every pew. They had no Bibles in the church. They might have a letter or a fragment or a copy of somebody's copy. Like you're meeting in Ephesus and Paul's written a letter to the Galatians. You might have had a copy of that, but good chance you didn't. And whatever scriptures you had, the minister would spend most of the time, you know, the pastor, he'd spend most of the time just reading the Bible. So that you could hang on every word and you'd have that and you'd try to memorize it as he was saying it. So you could go, because that was your big meal of the week. And then you would have to, all week long, you'd have to reflect upon those things that he read. He says, here, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of the scriptures. And to preaching and teaching. All three of those have to do with the word. If you're going to be a good minister, you're going to have to be a person of this book. If you're going to be a good servant, you've got to be a person of this book. He goes on here. He says, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of the scriptures, to preaching and teaching. And do not neglect the gift which was given you through prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. One appears that when Timothy was ordained, they were laying their hands on him. A prophet in the church made a prophetic utterance about Timothy and that he was receiving from God a specific gift. If I read the rest of Timothy, I'll find he says, stir up the gift of evangelism that's within you, okay? And so he's got this gift of being a soul winner. He goes out and he shares his faith with people, and people come to know Jesus. And he says, don't neglect that which came at the time of your ordination when you were launched into ministry. Then we come to my favorite verse in the whole book. It's this last verse, 4:15. I memorized this years ago. I was a young pastor. I was struggling in a church, and I didn't know where to turn. I said, well, you know, I should just probably turn to God. Somehow he directed me by his spirit to go to 1 Timothy, and I was reading, and this verse jumped off the page at me. I sat down to memorize it. I wasn't using the translation I have here. I was using I think it was the New American Standard Bible. I memorized it, and it says, pay close attention to yourself. You know, it's so easy to start paying attention to everybody else. You know how that works? This is how it works. You leave church, and you nudge your spouse, say, boy, I sure hope so-and-so was listening to that message because it was really good for them. You see what I'm saying? Pay close attention to yourself. Get your eyes off everybody else. He says, focus on yourself. If my slides were working, I got a picture up there. And it's a person with one of those mirrors in the bathroom, you know, the magnifying mirror. You know, where when you look in it, all you see is an eyeball. Because it shows everything, right? And I got one of those mirrors that says, look at yourself. And you see, you take the log out of your own eye before you try to take the speck out of somebody else. You look at yourself. That's what the text says. He says here, watch yourself and your life, or watch your life and your doctrine closely. So I'm watching my life in the one, myself. And then I got the other one over here in the mirror. The Bible says the Word of God is a mirror. I look into the mirror. So I see what the Word of God mirror says, and then I look at my life. Is what the Word and my life, are they one and the same? Pay close attention to yourself and to the Word, to your teaching. Watch your life and your doctrine closely. Persevere in them. In the slide, they got hands hanging onto those mirrors. Hands. Because persevering, you know, you're hanging on to it no matter what. Somebody says, what do you do when you get to the end of your rope? Well, you tie a knot, you hang on, you trust God, okay? You're hanging on, you're looking at yourself and you're looking in the Word, you're looking at yourself in your Word, and you're trying to make sure the two match so that the two are blended and they're one. You look in the Word, you say, there I am, right? He says, pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these, for if you do so, here's the promise. If you do so, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Wow. Wow. That's an awesome promise. Here I was struggling in my church and with my pastor, and I was focusing on people who were causing problems, and God says, let them go. Focus on yourself and the Word. Focus. You'll save yourself in ministry. You're going to save yourself, you know, from all the problems. You're going to save yourself. Listen, Jesus said, save yourself from this untoward generation. So there's a sense in which when I accepted Christ, I was my Savior because I accepted the Savior. And what I have in the slides is this guy's throwing out the life ring. Guy's out there drowning, his hand's just sticking out of the water, right? And he throws out the life ring. And the guy's out there, and the life ring says on it, Jesus Christ. And if he grabs the ring of Jesus Christ, he's saved. And if you grab it, you're saved. So in a secondary sense, if you accept Christ as your Savior, you've saved yourself from all the consequences of your sin. That's what he's saying here. If you pay close attention to yourself and to the Word, you'll save both yourself and those who are your hearers. You know what God said to me? He spoke to my heart. He said, Dennis, you focus on yourself. Like I said, be the example. I'll take care of everything else. Dennis, make sure that you got salvation locked in. You're living it out. Those then who hear you, they will follow in your steps. They'll get saved too. That's the promise. I think this is a glorious passage. I know you didn't get all the blanks here. And if you need the blanks, because some of you are detail people, just come after the service. I got them all written out. I do this every week in case technology fails. Here's what good ministers do. They point things out. They train in godliness. They hope in God. They teach the truth. They set an example. They focus on the Word. They give themselves wholly to God. And they watch themselves. They watch themselves. With the other mirror next to it, they watch themselves. The final slides I had said, I hope that's the kind of minister you want, because that's the kind of minister I want to be. I'm a little preoccupied with the Word. Oh, well. The list here doesn't say much about visitation, doesn't say much about counseling. It says about teaching and preaching. Because if I can get the Word of God into your life and I can be the example living it out and you're following in the steps and I'm following in the steps of Paul, who's following in the steps of Christ, we're going to be okay. We're going to be okay. God's going to bless this church. It may not be the way I'm expecting him to bless it, but he's going to bless it. He's promised to do so. So that's the kind of minister I want to be. But everybody's a minister. Everybody's a servant. I hope that's the kind of minister you want to be. Let's pray. Father in heaven, your word is powerful. It's rich. It's rewarding. It's exhilarating to look into this. And know this is what you want, and that means this is what I can be. Because you're not asking anything of me that you will not, by your Spirit, make me to become. Empower us through the Spirit of God to do the things good ministers do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.